إلا له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah's aid and assistance in all our affairs, and we beg His forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evils of our own souls and the consequences of our sins. Whomever Allah guides aright, none can misguide, and whomever Allah leaves astray, none can guide aright. I bear witness that none deserves worship but Allah alone, without partner, and I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah's final messenger and his most devout and sincere worshipper. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us in the Quran, O you who believe, fear Allah as he truly should be feared, and do not die except as Muslims. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, indeed the best speech is the speech of Allah, the words of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the worst of all things are those that are newly introduced and invented into the religion. Everything newly invented into the religion is a bid'ah, an innovation, and every innovation is misguidance, and every misguidance leads only to the fire. So today we continue reading through Shaykh Salih Al-Fawzan's commentary on Kitab al-Tawheed, the book on Islamic monotheism and correct belief about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yesterday we finished reading about the first verse which is mentioned by the author under this second chapter, Bab Fadl al-Tawheed wa ma yukathiru min al-Dhunub, chapter on the virtue and advantage of Tawheed and the sins that it expiates. And we spoke about the first ayah that the Shaykh, the author, mentions, and that's the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. It is those who believe and do not mix their belief with ظُلْم, الشِّرْك, here meaning polytheism. It is they who will have security and safety, and they are the ones who will be guided. We spoke a little bit about the background or the context of this ayah in relation to the da'wah, the call of Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam to his people who were idol worshippers, mushrikeen, polytheists. What we understand, or what the relevance, the Shaykh goes on to explain here, Shaykh Salih, the relevance of this verse to the chapter that we're talking about is that this verse proves the virtue and advantage of practicing at-tawheed, Islamic monotheism, worshipping Allah alone. It proves the virtue and advantage of practicing tawheed, and how at-tawheed is a cause for a person's sins to be expiated, to be forgiven, to be wiped clean. So this is part of the virtue of Tawheed and the sins it expiates, as is mentioned in the chapter title. So what do we learn from this verse? Number one, the virtue of Tawheed and its results, and its beautiful results and effects in this dunya and the akhirah, and in the hereafter. In this dunya, a person having the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remain upon the straight path, and having total aman, security and safety from being punished and tormented in the hereafter because of one's adherence to tawheed. Number two, أن الشرك ظلم مبطل للإيمان بالله إن كان أكبر أو منقص له إن كان أصغر. The second thing we learn from the verse is that ash-shirk, polytheism, associating partners with Allah, worshipping others alongside Allah, is a type of great injustice that invalidates a person's iman. It invalidates a person's faith in Allah if it was the major kind of shirk, if it's the kind of shirk which is known as major shirk, ash-shirkul akbar, which goes totally against iman. And if it is the lesser form of shirk, then it causes a deficiency in a person's belief in Allah. It causes a deficiency in a person's belief in Allah if it is the kind of shirk which is known as a shirk al-asghar, or the lesser form of shirk, which doesn't in of itself automatically totally take a person away from Islam. Now here's a question, just so that we understand the topic. Who can give me an example of a shirk al-asghar? Who can give me an example of a shirk al-akbar, major shirk? An action, a statement, or a belief which is major shirk? Worshipping a dead person or people in graves, worshipping them, directing any form of worship towards them, dua and so on and so forth. That is an example of major shirk, which totally goes against a person's belief in Allah. So who can give me an example of what is called minor shirk or lesser shirk? Not minor, it's not minor, but it's lesser shirk.
Yeah. Swearing by something other than Allah.
Swearing by other than Allah in word, if you don't believe that thing is as great as Allah or greater. Yeah? Just by accident, by word, through force of habit or bad manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, swearing by other than Allah. Okay? That's an example of the kind of shirk that doesn't automatically in of itself make a person a non-Muslim, but it really goes against the person's belief. It goes against his true and complete belief in Allah, but it doesn't take a person outside of the fold of Islam. That's one example of lesser shirk. And of course, lesser shirk, play down the seriousness of lesser shirk. We have to remember that lesser shirk is one of the greatest and most serious major sins, which can lead to the greater shirk. And that's some of the scholars, they actually define lesser shirk as any practice or statement that can lead to major shirk. Okay, that can lead to major shirk, even though it's not regarded as a major form of shirk in itself. So an example of that is swearing by other than Allah. It can lead to a person actually committing major shirk, because that person may fall into believing and having an esteem for the one or the thing that he's swearing by that becomes equal to Allah. And when that happens in his heart, then it's major shirk. Then it's major shirk. Another example is ar-riya. Ar-riya, showing off. When the ulama mention examples of minor shirk, or not minor, we shouldn't use the word minor, lesser shirk, then they give an example of what they say, occasional or a small amount of showing off. Right? Why do they say that? They say that because if a person's deeds, all of them, are showing off, then he's a kafir, he's a non-Muslim. That's major shirk. Right? When they say that showing off is an example of lesser shirk, then what they mean by that is when it happens occasionally, now and again. But if all of a person's deeds are that he's always doing it to impress other people, then that's major shirk. That is major shirk. We'll come on to that later on in the book, inshallah, when we explain Tawheed a bit further, as the author does. So that's the second point. The third thing that we learn from the ayah, أَنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَا يُغْفَرْ, that shirk, associating partners with Allah, is never forgiven. Is not forgiven. It's a sin which is not forgiven. Meaning, what is meant here? It's what is meant here is that it's not forgiven okay, unless there is a sincere tawbah before death, right? But if a person continues to commit shirk and dies having not repented sincerely from that shirk and coming back to tawheed, but that person dies upon shirk, then that shirk is something which you will be taken to account for and it will not be forgiven, contrary to other sins which are lesser than shirk that you may be forgiven for if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows in His grace and in His mercy and in His wisdom, He decides to forgive you for other sins that you have not repented from. We need to understand that. Every sin, right, every sin, if you repent from it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives it, if you truly repent from it, even shirk and kufr, right? But if you don't repent from it, if you don't repent from it and you die, then other sins, you may be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but a shirk will not be forgiven. Now there comes an issue which is discussed on this topic. When we say that shirk is not forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and as the verses of the Quran indicate, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah does not forgive that any partners be associated with Him, any shirk be done with Him, this is the dalil, this is the evidence for this, then the scholars ask the question, they discuss the issue, does this include lesser shirk? Or is it only major shirk which is not forgiven, like worshipping graves or slaughtering, sacrificial slaughters for other than Allah? These major, or sajda, making a prostration to an idol or anything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these are major shirk. Definitely these are included. But does that also include minor shirk? And what do we mean by that not being forgiven? We mean that a person will be punished for that, even though that person has not gone outside the fold of Islam, and even though that punishment will not be permanent, because the lesser shirk is major sin, it's a major form of sin. But the scholars have mentioned, and they've some scholars have different opinions on it based on the evidence, and Ibn Taymiyyah and others have, you know, they express some reservation in actually saying that minor shirk or lesser shirk is not included within that verse of the Quran that tells us that Allah does not forgive shirk. I mean, the evidence on that is not obvious and clear that those kind of sins could actually be forgiven. In fact, it seems to be more the case, according to some scholars, that every form of shirk, whether it's major or lesser form of shirk, will not be forgiven without tawbah. It will not be forgiven. If you show off, you impress someone else with a salah that you did or a recitation of Quran, if you don't repent from that, that shirk will not be forgiven, according to that understanding, which takes the most obvious and immediate kind of understanding from verses that talk about shirk. Because that shirk is not differentiated, there's no differentiation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say lesser shirk will be forgiven and treated as other sins are, but major shirk will not. There's nothing like that clear in the book and the sunnah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. The fourth point is أن الشرك يسبب الخوف في الدنيا والآخرة. A shirk, associating partners with Allah, is a cause of fear in this dunya, in this life, and in the hereafter. That those people who associate partners with Allah, their shirk is a cause for them to fear the punishment of Allah, to fear the attack of an enemy, anything which they fear which is harmful to them in this dunya as well as the akhirah in the hereafter. The cause of such fear of such things, that these dangers, you know, a person becomes he exposes himself to these dangers, the cause of this is ash-shirk, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, it's those who believe and do not mix their belief with al-dhulm or with dhulm, which is in this ayah polytheism, those are the ones who have aman, those are the ones who have safety and security. So implicitly it means that a person who doesn't have tawheed, a person who mixes his iman with shirk, is a person who will not have aman. He has no guarantee of safety in this world or in the hereafter. he should live in fear. The second text which the author rahimahullah ta'ala mentions under this chapter is the following hadith. An Ubadah ibn Samit radiyallahu anhu qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man shahida an la ilaha illa Allah wahdahu la sharika lah, wa anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu, wa anna Isa abdullah wa rasuluhu, wa kalimatuhu alqaha ila Maryama wa ruhun minhu, wal jannata haqqun wan nar haqqun, أدخله الله الجنة على ما كان من العمل. In this hadith reported by Ubadah ibn Samit radiyallahu anhu, who said, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever testifies that no deity deserves worship but Allah alone without partner, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah's devoted slave, servant and messenger, and Isa, Jesus, is the abd of Allah, the servant and worshipper of Allah, and his Rasul and his messenger, and a statement from Allah, a word from Allah which Allah sent to Maryam, to Mary, and is a soul created by Allah, is a soul, a ruh from Allah. And whoever bears witness that Al-Jannah, paradise, is true, and An-Nar, the hellfire, is true, أَدْخَلَهُ اللَّهُ الْجَنَّةَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنَ الْعَمَلِ, whoever bears witness to all these things, Allah will admit that person into paradise with whatever actions that person has done, with whatever deeds that person has done, he will be admitted into paradise by Allah. And this hadith is reported by Al-Bukhari and Muslim and Tirmidhi and others. So the Shaykh Saleh says, the reporter Ubadah ibn Samit, the companion Ubadah ibn Samit, is Ubadah ibn Samit ibn Qais al-Ansari al-Khazraji. So he was from the Ansar, from the tribe of Al-Khazraj, one of the two major tribes of the Ansar. What was the other major tribe of the Ansar? Aus. He is one of the Nuqaba, one of the well-known warriors from the participated in the Battle of Badr, and famous for his bravery, famous for his participation in Al-Badr, Battle of Badr. And he died in the year 34 after the Hijrah at the age of 72. May Allah Ta'ala be pleased with him. He reports this hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the first thing mentioned in the hadith is whoever shahida an la ilaha illallah, whoever testifies that la ilaha illallah, it means that a person says this word. A person says this statement, La ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, knowing its meaning and acting, living in accordance with what it necessitates, with what it means, outwardly and inwardly. That's what it means to testify that La ilaha illallah. To say this with your mouth, to say it with your tongue, and to believe it and understand it in one's heart, to understand its meaning and to act according to it inwardly and outwardly, in your feelings and beliefs and in your outward actions. And we know that La ilaha illallah, this statement, none deserves worship but Allah, means La ma'buda bihaqqin illallah, there is none to be worshipped in truth, or none deserves worship but Allah. That's what it means when we say La ilaha illallah. And from this, and we will discuss this more as we look at the further explanation of Tawheed and the tafsir of the Shahada, the explanation of what the Shahada means, we understand from this that it's a mistake or it's a deficiency when people say, or they try to express La ilaha illallah in English and they say there is no God but Allah, or something of this same kind of meaning. It's a bit deficient, it doesn't really give the full meaning of what this statement says. In fact, it has some problems. It's problematic to actually translate it like this. Rather, the real meaning of La ilaha illallah is none deserves worship but Allah. None deserves worship, or there is no deity deserving worship but Allah. And we'll come on to that a bit later. So, these are the things that are mentioned, that if a person bears witness to them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will admit him to paradise, whatever actions, on whatever actions that person has done. So that includes saying the shahada la ilaha illallah and Muhammad Rasulullah and Jesus Isa is the messenger of Allah and also the servant, the worshipper of Allah. And so when we say, the Shaykh mentions that when a person bears witness that Isa, Jesus, alayhi salam, son of Mary, is the abd of Allah, the servant of Allah and the worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Rasul, the messenger, a messenger from Allah, this is in contrary to what the Christians believe, that either Jesus is Allah, or he is the son of Allah, or that he is one in the Trinity. The statement where it says وَكَلِمَتُهُ, where Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and whoever bears witness that Jesus is the abd of Allah, is the servant and worshipper of Allah, and his Messenger, وَكَلِمَتُهُ أَلْقَاهَا إِلَى مَرْيَمْ, and the statement of Allah, a word from Allah that he sent to Maryam. What does that mean? What that means is أَنَّهُ خَلَقَهُ بِكَلِمَةٍ وَهِيَ قَوْلُهُ كُنْ. It means that when we say that Jesus is the word, or a word from Allah, it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Jesus, created Isa alayhi salam, by saying kun, be. As we know in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that when Allah wants something to be, he just says kun fayakun. He says be and it is. And this is what is meant here, that Isa alayhi salam is the kalima, or is the word from Allah, meaning that he was created from the, or brought about through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying simply kun, be, and he was. And when the hadith mentions wa ruhun minhu, and anyone who bears witness that Isa, Jesus, is a ruh, a soul from him, from Allah, it means أن عيسى عليه السلام روح من الأرواح التي خلقها الله تعالى. When we say that Jesus is a spirit, is a ruh, is a soul, it means he is one of the souls, one of the many souls that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. He's a created soul. Just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created many other souls, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the soul of Isa alayhi salam. And then it says minhu, from him. Okay, what does that mean, from Allah? Means that it comes from Allah, meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created it and brought it about. This is something we should understand. It's obvious to us according to our belief. We should understand it, because sometimes people misunderstand. They try to interpret maybe these kind of verses in the light of what Christians believe, or Christians themselves sometimes try to mention that these type of references to Isa alayhi salam somehow prove the belief of the Christians that Jesus is from Allah, literally part of Allah or part of a Trinity. So we should understand what these mean. When it says that Allah, that Isa alayhi salam is a ruh, is a soul from Allah, minhu, it says in the ayah, minhu, coming from Allah, it means that Allah created it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this soul and brought it about. Just like we say, and the evidence for this is in the ayah, is in another verse of the Quran, in Surah Al-Jathiyah, verse 13, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مِّنْهُ. that Allah made subservient to you whatever is in the heavens and in the earth, all of it is from Him. All of it is from Him, meaning it is Allah who created these things and brought them into existence for you. He is the one who has given them to you, so it's from Him in that sense, not literally from Him meaning being part of Him, which is clear from this verse that the heavens and the earth are not from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the sense of literally being part of Him. And therefore the same thing when we say that Isa alayhi salam ruhum minhu is a soul from Allah, meaning a soul sent from by Allah, created by Allah and sent to Maryam. And then the next part of the hadith says, lists wal jannata haqqun wan nara haqqun. And he also had to bear witness that al jannah, paradise, is true, and an nar, hellfire, is true. Meaning that a person also testifies, he also declares, he also bears witness that paradise and hellfire, both of which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has informed us about in His book, are true and there is no doubt about them. Paradise and hellfire, which have been described in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has informed us about these two places, these two creations, that these things we also must bear witness that they are true, there is no doubt about them. And then the hadith ends, أَدْخَلَهُ اللَّهُ الْجَنَّةَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنَ الْعَمَلِ. Allah will admit that person who bears witness to all these things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will admit him into Jannah, into paradise, upon whatever actions, whatever deeds he had done. What does that mean? Sheikh Salih Al-Fawzan says this has two possible meanings. This has two possible meanings. The first, أَدْخَلَهُ اللَّهُ الْجَنَّةَ وَإِنْ كَانَ مُقَصِّرًا وَلَهُ ذُنُوبٌ لِأَنَّ الْمُوَحِّدَ لَا بُدَّ لَهُ مِنْ دُخُولِ الْجَنَّةِ. The first interpretation is that this statement in the hadith means that Allah will admit such a person into paradise even if he has fallen short in his deeds and he has some sins that he had done. And that's what is meant by عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنَ الْعَمَلِ, according or despite the actions that he did. In this case we would translate it as despite the actions he had done, meaning he had sins, and despite that fact, Allah will forgive him and enter him into, or admit him into paradise. Because the muwahid, the person who practices tawheed, true belief in Allah, worshipping Allah alone, must necessarily in the end enter Jannah as Allah has promised. So that's the first possible meaning of this part of the hadith. The second possible meaning is أَدْخَلَهُ اللَّهُ الْجَنَّةِ وَتَكُونُ مَنْزِلَتُهُ فِيهَا عَلَى حَسَبِ عَمَلِهِ. The second possibility, and there is no harm, there's a rule actually that in Islam, that the ulama point out, we shouldn't understand that one is wrong and the other is correct. If there are two possible meanings which are not contradictory, they are both possible in a text from the book and the sunnah, there is a rule that many scholars point out that in general, if there are two possible meanings, both of which actually have other evidence that support those meanings, then we can accept both of them as the intended meaning. We don't have to say one is right and the other is wrong. Okay? So the first possible interpretation, or the first possible message we get from this, is that Allah will enter a person, admit such a person into paradise, even if he has sins. The second interpretation is that a person who bears witness to these things will be admitted to paradise by Allah, and his rank in Jannah, his status in Jannah will be in accordance with the deeds that he had done. So the one who had more good deeds and better good deeds will have a higher status, and the one who had less deeds or had some sins would have a lesser status in paradise. Okay, so those are the two possible interpretations from this part of the hadith, that Allah will admit such a person to paradise upon the action that he did, upon the actions that he did. Two meanings, and in fact both of them in reality, and Allah knows best, both of them have evidence, they both are in accordance with other texts of the Quran and the Sunnah. There are texts in the Quran and Sunnah which tell us that a person who lives and dies upon Tawheed will eventually be forgiven his sins and admitted into paradise. This is one very essential aspect of our belief, and we've been reading about it and listening about it in the chapter that we've been reading. There are other texts in the Quran and Sunnah which also tell us that people are of different ranks in paradise. Not all the people of paradise are the same. The prophets and messengers and the true believers and the shuhada, the martyrs and the righteous, all have their rank. And the people of paradise, the believers, will have their ranks in paradise in different levels according to their level of righteousness, their level of iman, their righteous deeds. So both these meanings are correct, and therefore they can both be accepted as part of the message of this hadith. And in fact, many ulama point out that this is from the fadl, this is from the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said in the hadith, أُوتِيتُ جَوَامِعُ الْكَلِمِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. I have been given جَوَامِعُ الْكَلِمِ, I have been given comprehensive words. Comprehensive words, meaning that the Prophet ﷺ would say something which was one sentence in a few words, but the meaning would be very great and a lot of benefit could be derived from it. He had been given this by Allah, that the Prophet ﷺ could say one hadith, one statement, one sentence, and a lot of knowledge can be derived and understood from that statement. So inshallah, this is from that. Okay, so this hadith is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. The general, therefore, message that we get from this verse, this hadith, is that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam informs us in this hadith, explaining to us the virtue and advantage of Tawheed and the nobility of this belief and living upon At-Tawheed. He told us sallallahu alayhi wasallam that whoever speaks the Shahadatain, whoever says the Shahadatain, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, knowing the meaning of what he is saying, acting in accordance with what he is saying, outwardly and inwardly, and if that person avoids falling short of the mark or going to extremes in regards to the prophets, meaning he doesn't reject Isa alayhi salam as the Jews did, and he doesn't exaggerate in his praise of Isa raising him to the level of divinity, but a person is correct when he comes to his belief with regards to the prophets like Jesus alayhi salam, and if a person, and these two noble prophets specifically here are mentioned, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Isa alayhi salam, and if a person agrees and affirms that they also were sent by Allah with a message from Allah, these two messengers, and they don't have both of these messengers, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Isa alayhi salam, Jesus, both of them or none of them share in the qualities of divinity, none of them have attributes that make them in any way divine, they were men, messengers from Allah, and they were servants of Allah and worshippers of Allah, and a person, if he has all this, he believes all this, and he also believes and he's sure that about Jannah, about paradise and about the hellfire, then such a person's end will be that he will end up in Jannah. He will end up in paradise, even if there are some sins, that he commits some sins, which are lesser than a shirk. The relevance of this hadith to the chapter then, and the chapter is about the virtue of Tawheed and the sins it expiates, the relevance of this hadith to that chapter is, in this hadith, there is an explanation of this great advantage of being upon Tawheed, and that it is a cause, that being upon Tawheed is a cause for entering paradise, it's a way to enter paradise and to have one's sins expiated. And that was the intent behind that chapter. So what do we learn from this hadith? Again, in more detail, in point form. Number one, we learn from this hadith the virtue and superiority of Tawheed, and that Allah expiates a person's sins if a person is upon Tawheed. Secondly, the immense grace of Allah and His benevolence, subhanahu wa ta'ala, towards His creatures. towards his servants. This forgiveness and this him admitting such people into paradise. Thirdly, wujub tajannub al-ifrat wa al-tafreet fi haqq al-anbiya wa al-salihin, the obligation of avoiding and staying away from falling short of the mark or going over the mark and exaggerating with regards to praise and respect of the prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's obligatory to be balanced in this regard, such that we do not go fall short of the mark, such that we do not give respect and praise and reverence to the prophets and messengers of Allah, as some of the people of the past have done, who rejected prophets and didn't accept prophets, didn't respect them, spoke of them in a bad way, described them in unbefitting terms. And also, it's obligatory to avoid exaggeration and extremism in one's attitude towards the prophets and messengers, such that there are, you know, a person ends up treating them as if they were gods besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, calling upon them, believing such beliefs about them that take them outside the realm of being human and into the realm of being divine. So this is obligatory, to avoid all forms of extremism either way with regards to the Anbiya, the prophets, and the Salihin, and the righteous, of course, because if we do this with the prophets, we must therefore also do that with the righteous Muslims, righteous people of the past and present. فَلَا نَجْحَدُ فَضْلَهُمْ وَلَا نَغْلُو فِيهِمْ فَنَصْرِفُ لَهُمْ شَيْءٌ مِّنَ الْعِبَادَةِ كَمَا يَفْعَلُ بَعْضُ الْجُهَّالِ وَالضُّلَّالِ. So we do not deny their virtue. We do not deny the superiority of prophets and messengers and also the righteous. We do not deny that. And at the same time, we do not go extreme such that we direct any form of ibadah, any form of worship towards them, as some of the ignorant and misguided people do. Fourthly, أن عقيدة التوحيد تخالف جميع الملل الكفرية من اليهود والنصارى والوثنيين والدهريين. Fourthly, we have to understand this very important point in this day and age for those of us who are living here, particularly, that we need to be reminded of this, although it's an obvious point. That the aqeedah, the belief, the creed of Tawheed contradicts, it goes against, it is contrary to all other religions. It goes against, it is different from all other religions that are involved in kufr, that are involved in disbelieving in Allah, like Judaism, Christianity, pagan religions or polytheistic religions, idolatrous religions, and ad-dahriyin, those who don't believe in any creator, atheistic kind of ways of life. Because it's a way of life. Being an atheist is a way of life. So we have to understand that, as is confirmed in these kind of texts, that the beliefs of a Muslim go totally against the belief of Jews, the belief of Christians, the belief of polytheists and pagan kind of pagan religion, and also that of atheists and people who just believe in the material world and do not believe in Allah or a creator at all. We need to be clear about that. We need to be very clear and understand that. And the last point, fifthly, أَنَّ عُصَاتَ الْمُوَحِّدِينَ لَا يُخَلَّدُونَ فِي النَّارِ. Very important point of aqeedah, that the sinners, people who have sinned amongst those who are upon Tawheed, those who do not worship others besides Allah, but they believe in Allah and they maintain Tawheed in their life, they worship Allah alone and they do not associate partners with Him. Those of the Muwahideen, those monotheists who fall into sin, such people who do sins, they will not dwell eternally in the fire. They will not enter the hellfire permanently, even if they're punished by Allah. But it has to be understood that a person of Tawheed will eventually be saved from the fire and will eventually be admitted to paradise if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides to punish that person before admitting him into paradise. He will eventually enter paradise. They will not live. They will not be in the fire forever. In another hadith, the next hadith mentioned in the chapter, the author says, "Rahimahullah, walahuma fi hadith itban." فإن الله حرم على النار من قال لا إله إلا الله يبتغي بذلك وجه الله. So the author says, and also in Bukhari and Muslim, from the hadith of Itban, hadith reported by Itban, may Allah be pleased with him, indeed Allah has forbidden for the fire anyone who says لا إله إلا الله, seeking by that the face of Allah. Seeking by that, the face of Allah, seeking by that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his intention. Itban, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, is Itban ibn Malik ibn Amr ibn al-Ajlan al-Ansari min Bani Salim ibn Auf. So this companion Itban, his full name is Itban, the son of Malik, the son of Amr, the son of Ajlan, from the Ansar, from the tribe of Salim, from the tribe of Salim ibn Auf, a famous companion. He died during the caliphate of Muawiyah, Allah be pleased with them. When the hadith says harrama ala an-nar, Allah has forbidden to the fire, it means that Allah has prevented and stopped the fire from touching such a person. The statement يَبْتَغِي بِذَلِكَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ, seeking the face of Allah by saying this shahada, the one who says لا إله إلا الله, seeking by it the face of Allah. What does that mean? It means أي مُخْلِصًا مِنْ قَلْبِهِ وَمَاتَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ وَلَمْ يَقُلْهَا نِفَاقًا. It means that the person is sincere and pure in his intention from his heart. He said it from the heart, purely and sincerely, and died upon that. And he did not say La ilaha illallah out of hypocrisy, pretending. Meaning he didn't believe it and mean it in his heart. He didn't seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure through it, but he wanted to get some other benefit by saying La ilaha illallah, by either getting the acceptance of people, or he had some other intention. He wanted to show that he was a Muslim. He didn't do it out of nifaq. He didn't do it hypocritically, but he did it sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what do we get from this hadith? The general meaning here is that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is informing us very in strong terms, or in very clear terms, that anyone who says the statement La ilaha illallah, intending by saying this what this statement actually means, of being sincere to Allah, having a pure intention to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure, and negating and staying away from any shirk, associating partners with Allah, whoever says it with this kind of intention, with this kind of feeling in the heart, acting in according to that outwardly and inwardly, and a person who does this and dies upon this, in this state, then the fire will not touch that person on Yawmul Qiyamah. The hellfire will not touch that person on the day of resurrection. Therefore, the relevance of this hadith to the chapter is أَنَّ فِيهِ دِلَالَةٌ وَاضِحَةٌ عَلَى فَضْلِ التَّوْحِيدِ وَأَنَّهُ يُوجِبُ لِمَنْ مَاتَ عَلَيْهِ النَّجَاةَ مِنَ النَّارِ وتكفير السيئات. In this hadith, this is the relevance of the hadith. In this hadith, there is clear evidence of the fadl, the virtue and superiority, the advantage of tawheed, and that it necessitates tawheed means that a person who dies upon it will be in Jannah. He's guaranteed paradise. Paradise, meaning he will be saved from the fire. He is guaranteed to be saved from the fire, and he will have his sins expiated. He will have sins expiated. So that's why the hadith is relevant to the chapter. What we get from this hadith in the following points. Number one, فضل التوحيد وأنه ينقذ من النار ويكفر الخطايا. The virtue of tawheed, the advantage of tawheed, and that tawheed saves a person from hell and expiates sins. Two, أنه لا يكفي في الإيمان النطق من غير اعتقاد القلب كحال المنافقين. Two, second point is that it is not sufficient to have iman, to have an acceptable iman, that a person just says something on his tongue without believing it in the heart, just like the munafiqeen are, the hypocrites, who say upon their tongues what they don't believe in the heart. That's not enough for iman. The third point, أنه لا يكفي في الإيمان الاعتقاد من غير نطق كحال الجاحدين. A very important point. The reverse is also true. That it is not enough for a person to have iman, for a person to be regarded as being upon al-iman. It's not enough for him. It's not sufficient that he should just say this, that he should believe this in his heart without saying it. Like the jahideen. The jahideen are those who openly deny. They reject Islam openly. Even in their hearts they may believe it's true. Such people do not have iman. Okay? So, we can't think that a person, oh, he knows the truth, he must be a Muslim. No, he hasn't said, he hasn't declared his belief. And in fact, that is the state of the most of the kuffar. Most of the kuffar in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially their leaders, knew the truth. They knew that Muhammad was a messenger from Allah. But they rejected it. They refused to say la ilaha illallah. And they wouldn't say it, even though they believed it was true in their hearts. So that doesn't make a person a believer, that he knows the truth, believes it in his heart, and then he won't declare it, he won't say it. That's not enough. So that's the flip side of the munafiq. The munafiq is the one who says that he believes, but doesn't in his heart. The other side is the jahid, the one who just a denier. He's a denier. He's a person who believes that something is true, but actually denies it openly for his own particular reasons, either out of pride or arrogance or whatever, out of fear of his society or his whatever. So that's not enough for iman either. Fourthly, تحريم النار على أهل التوحيد الكامل, that the fire is absolutely forbidden, will absolutely be stopped from touching those people who have complete tawheed, who have a perfect and complete tawheed in their lives. Firstly, أن العمل لا ينفع إلا إذا كان خالصا لوجه الله وصوابا على سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Fifthly, a deed, any deed that a person does will not benefit that person except if it is done خالصا لوجه الله, purely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure, purely seeking the face of Allah, to see Allah and to get His pleasure, and also being done correctly according to the sunnah of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first aspect, or the first thing, or the first requirement that it should be sincere for Allah is mentioned in this hadith that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stipulated this condition for a person to be saved from the fire, that he should say la ilaha illallah, يَبْتَغِي بِذَلِكَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ, seeking Allah's reward, seeking Allah's face. So that means the sincerity part. The second thing about it having to be correct, can anyone mention the evidence from the book or the sunnah that an action, a worship must also be correct as well as sincere? It must be done in accordance with the sunnah. Where is the evidence for that? Questions? Yeah. Jazakallah khair. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, amongst the numerous texts that prove this point, is the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as the brother mentioned, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدْ. Whoever does an action which we have not commanded, which we have not instructed, then it is rejected. So as well as being sincere, an act of worship must also be correct. It's not enough that we say we are sincere, that we want to do good. It also has to be in accordance with the sunnah of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The next point, point six, I think, is it six we're on? Yeah. The sixth point, أَنَّ مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَهُوَ يَدْعُو غَيْرَ اللَّهِ لَمْ تَنْفَعْهُ كَحَالِ عُبَّادِ الْقُبُورِ الْيَوْمِ يَقُولُونَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَهُمْ يَدْعُونَ الْمَوْتَى وَيَتَقَرَّبُونَ إِلَيْهِمْ. The next point is that whoever says لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ while at the same time calling and making dua, supplicating to other than Allah, then this statement will not benefit that person. Whether he says La ilaha illallah won't benefit him as long as he is worshipping others besides Allah. And this is like the case with the Ubad al-Qubur, those who worship graves in this day and age. Those who say La ilaha illallah, they say we're Muslims, they say La ilaha illallah, but at the same time they call upon the dead. They make dua to the dead and they seek closeness to them, such that you will go to some places and you will find people making tawaf around graves, you will find people sacrificing animals like you should do for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You find them doing that for the people who are dead in the graves. That statement, La ilaha illallah, will not benefit those people as long as they are doing these other kinds of worship to others besides Allah. Seventh point, إثبات الوجه لله تعالى على ما يليق بجلاله وعظمته. This hadith seventhly affirms the attribute that Allah has a face, that Allah has a wajh, a face, according to His majesty, His uniqueness and His greatness. We don't know how, we don't know what how it is. But this hadith, as well as numerous other texts in the book and the sunnah, affirms this wajh, that Allah has a face. And this, of course, according to the principle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the most perfect attributes, that this attribute of Allah's face, just like every other attribute that is affirmed for Allah, is according to Allah's majesty and Allah's greatness, something that we cannot imagine. But we affirm it as it is, we have been told by Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this hadith and other texts. Okay, so we'll do one more text, inshallah ta'ala, or perhaps hold it, we might be able to finish. Yeah, we can finish the chapter, inshallah. The next hadith in this chapter, the author rahimahullah says, وعن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال قال موسى يا رب علمني شيئا أذكرك وأدعوك به قال قل يا موسى لا إله إلا الله قال يا رب كل عبادك يقولون هذا قال يا موسى لو أن السماوات السبع وعامرهن غيري والأراضين السبع في كفة ولا إله إلا الله في كفة مالت بهن لا إله إلا الله رواه ابن حبان والحاكم وصححه. The next narration, the next hadith mentioned by the author here is reported by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu, who said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Musa, Moses, the Prophet Moses said, O my Lord, teach me something I can remember you by and mention you by and call upon you by, or call upon you using these words. Allah said, say, O Musa, La ilaha illallah. Musa said, O my Lord, all of your worshippers and your servants say this. Allah said, O Moses, O Musa, if the seven heavens and all that is in them apart from me, meaning that Allah is separate from His creation, if the seven heavens and all that is in them apart from me and the seven earths were in one side or one side of the scales, and La ilaha illallah was placed on the other side of the scales, La ilaha illallah would outweigh all of them. La ilaha illallah would outweigh all of them. And this hadith is reported by Ibn Hibban and Al-Hakim in their collections of hadith, as well as others. An-Nasa'i in his Sunnah, An-Nasa'i also in Amalul Yawmi wal Layla. And a hadith is differed over with regards to its authenticity, with regards to whether it is authentic or not by the hadith scholars. But we will explain the hadith according to those who say that it is authentic. We'll, as the Shaykh does here, he explains the hadith. So this hadith, inshallah, perhaps by tomorrow I'll maybe mention a few more words about the hadith or what scholars have discussed about the authenticity of the hadith. So this hadith is reported by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu. His full name is Abu Sa'id al-Khudri Sa'd ibn Malik ibn Sinan al-Khazraji al-Ansari al-Khudri nisbatan ila bani Khudra. So Abu, this famous companion, his kunya is Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. His name is Sa'd ibn Malik ibn Sinan, from the tribe of Khazraj, from the Ansar. Al-Khudri is an attribution to the tribe of Khudra. He was a noble and famous companion, and in fact he was the son of a companion. Both he and his father were companions, may Allah be pleased with them both. He reported many, many ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He died in the year 74 of the Hijrah. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, famous companion and famous reporter of many ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah be pleased with him and his father. So this hadith mentions Musa alayhi salam, and what is intended by Musa, of course, here is Musa, the son of Imran, the messenger of Allah to Bani Israel, to the children of Israel, and the one to whom Allah spoke to directly, Prophet Moses. When in this hadith it's mentioned where Musa said, "Oh Allah, teach me something that I can remember you by, أذكرك به," it means that I can praise you by, that I can use to praise you. وَأَدْعُوكَ بِهِ, and I can call upon you with, means I can use as a means of calling upon you and as a means of you accepting my call. So in this hadith also, when the hadith says وَعَامِرُهُنَّ غَيْرِي, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in this part of the hadith, if, O Musa, if the seven heavens and all that is in them apart from me. That bit means that it includes everything and everyone that is in the heavens and the earth, and of course it does not include Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith mentions fi kiffa, in one side, or in Arabic kiffa means one tray or one side of the scales. Kiffa, here the hadith is telling us that if all of these creatures of Allah, everything in the seven heavens and the seven earths and everything that is in them was placed in one side of the scales, and if the statement La ilaha illallah was placed on another side of the scales, the other side of the scales, then La ilaha illallah would outweigh all of the heavens and the earth and everything in them. So what is the general message from this hadith? Well, Musa alayhi salam sought, he asked from his Lord Allah Azza wa Jal that Allah would teach him a dhikr, a type of remembrance by which he could praise Allah by, and that he could seek closeness to Allah, and he could seek a means to Allah by. So Allah guided him and instructed him to say La ilaha illallah. Musa realized and remembered that this statement, La ilaha illallah, is mentioned a lot. Many people say this statement. It is mentioned upon many people's tongues. Many of the creatures of Allah say this. But Musa wanted something that was special for him. He wanted Allah to give him a specific or special kind of dua, a specific type of dhikr. And he realized that every servant of Allah, worship of Allah, says La ilaha illallah. But Musa wanted something special. Something that he could be distinguished with in remembering Allah. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained to him and clarified to him the great virtue and superiority of this statement, of this dhikr, of saying La ilaha illallah, and that there is nothing which equals it in virtue. That there is nothing that equals it in virtue. So the relevance of this hadith to the chapter is that in this hadith there is an explanation, a clarification of this fadl, this great superiority of the statement of Tawheed. Because La ilaha illallah is the statement of Tawheed. It expresses the concept and idea of Tawheed. So this hadith tells us the great status, the great virtue that it has, and that there is nothing that equals it in its superiority, in its virtue. Nothing equals it in this heavens and in the earth. What we learn from the hadith in the following points. Number one, the immense virtue and superiority of La ilaha illallah, because of the meaning, the message of Tawheed and ikhlas, sincerity and purity towards in worshipping Allah. Because of this message, this statement La ilaha illallah has this great status and great superiority. Two, فضل موسى عليه السلام وحرصه على التقرب إلى الله. In this hadith there is a great virtue of the Prophet Musa, the Prophet Moses. It shows us how much he was concerned and enthusiastic, and how much he cared to worship Allah and get closer to Allah by pleasing Allah and worshipping Allah and remembering Allah. It shows how much he wanted this. Shows the great virtue and superiority of the Prophet Musa alayhi salam. Thirdly, أن العبادة لا تكون إلا بما شرعه الله وليس للإنسان أن يبتدع فيها من عند نفسه لأن موسى طلب من ربه أن يعلمه ما يذكره به. Very important point. Number three, this hadith shows us that al-ibada, worship of Allah, cannot be done except with what Allah has legislated, what Allah has taught. And it is not allowed for a person to innovate and invent some kind of worship from his own opinion and from his own ideas. How do we know this? Because Musa, the Prophet of Allah himself, asked Allah to teach him a statement of dhikr to remember him by. Musa didn't make up anything, and he's the Prophet of Allah. He is Kalimullah. He's the one who Allah spoke to directly. And yet he did not go forth and try to invent some kind of statement. He actually asked Allah to teach him, what can I remember you by? What can I call you and say as dhikr? So this indicates to us that a person is not allowed to just invent any kind of bid'ah or dhikr that he wants. The next point is that anything, that's number four here, anything that people are in dire and real need of is something that Allah makes more available and easier for people to get. This is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's way, that when there is something that people need and it's needed by people, it's essential, then Allah makes that available and makes it most available. Meaning here that people are in most need of La ilaha illallah. They are most in need of this, of Tawheed. And since the people are in need of Tawheed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made Tawheed available to everyone, made it easy for people to understand and enter into, because he made this statement, La ilaha illallah, a very brief sentence that is so great. It's such a great and important sentence, but Allah made it easy. That anyone who speaks any language, whether he's Arab or non-Arab, can say La ilaha illallah and understand its meaning and believe in it and then accept it as his way of life. Fifthly, أَنَّ اللَّهَ فَوْقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ لِقَوْلِهِ وَعَامِرُهُنَّ غَيْرِي. In this hadith, there is another, yet another of the numerous pieces of evidence or evidences in the book and the sunnah that Allah is above the heavens. Because this hadith says that Allah said, وَآمِرُهُنَّ غَيْرِي, and all those that are in the heavens and the earth, all those that are in the heavens who are not from me or apart from me. So in this part of the hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned that He Himself is separate from the heavens and all those that are in the heavens. It means that Allah is above the heavens. He is separate from His creation, which is the aqeedah of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah, the Orthodox Sunni Muslims. Sixthly, أنه لا بد في الذكر بهذه الكلمة من التلفظ بها كلها لا ولا يقتصر على لفظ الجلالة الله كما يفعله بعض الجهال. Six, very important point. Again, to remember Allah with this kalima, the shahada, la ilaha illallah, one is required to say it in its entirety. One is required to say it in its entirety, and one is not to restrict oneself to saying just the name of Allah, 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 as some of the ignorant and misguided people do. And Sheikh mentions them, the Sufiya, the Sufis, the misguided Sufis. That there are some people who have instituted a kind of dhikr whereby they have slowly taken away bits of the shahada to get right down to the just restricting it to Allah's name. So that when they want to remember Allah, they say Allah, 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 Allah. And this is something which has no any basis in the practice of the Prophet ﷺ, neither in the Quran, neither in the Sunnah. It doesn't have any practice from the way of the Salaf. And this hadith indicates that there is that actually, if you want to remember Allah, if you want to remember Allah by this statement, La ilaha illallah, then you have to say La ilaha illallah. How do we understand that? From a number of angles. First, it is what Allah taught Musa alayhi salam. Musa sought from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the best way to remember Him and to call upon Him. And Allah taught him to say La ilaha illallah. Allah didn't say to His messenger and His prophet Musa, of course Allah is going to teach His prophets and messengers what is best. Allah didn't say to Musa, say Allah, 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 Allah. He said, say La ilaha illallah. And secondly, when a person just says Allah and tries to use this as dhikr, there's no meaning of dhikr there. Neither is it a dua. Neither is it supplicating to Allah or praising Allah. It's not even praising Allah. When you say Allah, you're not even praising Allah. So there's no meaning of dhikr, there's no meaning of remembrance in there. So from this we understand the mistake and the innovation of some of the misguided sects and people who actually make this an essential part of remembering Allah, is that you have to remember Allah by repeating this word, and then they do it in all kinds of different and innovated ways, and they connect all different kinds of meanings and all different kinds of virtues to it, none of which has any basis in the book and in the sunnah. And from this we also, as some of the ulama mashayikh have pointed out, we find that related to this is a mistake that some people make, and that is even writing Allah's name on its own, just Allah, as a piece of decoration or as a way to remember Allah. Now this is actually similar in some way to what the Sufis and people of innovation have done, where they just use Allah's name alone and they put it in a picture, or they put it in a some kind of decoration and they stick it up or whatever. That this actually is relate more, it's closer to this innovation than being closer to the sunnah, because the sunnah is to remember Allah, to say La ilaha illallah, to say Subhanallah, to say Allahu Akbar. As for remembering Allah with just the word Allah, then this is not from any kind of remembrance. It's not a dhikr, it's not something that the Prophet ﷺ did, it's not something that the Sahaba did, and therefore it's a mistake to use just the word Allah as a form of dhikr like that. Okay, and the next point is Number 7, إثبات ميزان الأعمال وأنه حق. Another point of Aqeedah, which again can be expanded upon with evidence from the book and the Sunnah. This hadith affirms that there is a mizan, that there is a scale, there are some balances whereby people's actions will be weighed on the day of resurrection. Why? Because it is mentioned in the hadith that if La ilaha illallah were put on one side of the scales. La ilaha illallah is a statement that a person says. So this indicates that there will be, as many other, as other texts of the Quran and Sunnah show us, teach us, that Allah will weigh people's actions. And we don't know exactly how this will be, and what form, or what physical form this will take, but that there is something called al-mizan. There are scales of balance. There is a balance that Allah has created that will weigh the actions of people on Yawmul Qiyamah. So those, and this is mentioned in the verses of the Quran, those whose deeds are heavy, whose good deeds are heavy, those whose evil deeds or sins are heavy, then the consequences for them will be in accordance with that. The eighth point, the eighth point, أن الأنبياء يحتاجون إلى التنبيه على فضل لا إله إلا الله. The eighth point here reminds us that even the prophets can sometimes need to be reminded of the virtue of لا إله إلا الله. We should not look down, or we should not undermine the importance of لا إله إلا الله. It is so important and so virtuous and so superior as a statement and as a belief that even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remind His prophets and messengers about the virtue of this statement. And even they sometimes need to be reminded of it, because it is so important. Ninthly, أَنَّ الْأَرَضِينَ سَبْعٌ كَالسَّمَاوَاتِ. This last point is that this hadith affirms, and as is mentioned in, I think, some other texts, that just like there are seven heavens, there are seven earths. There are seven earths. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best the nature, location, and, you know, modality of these seven earths. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. But this hadith affirms that just like the heavens are seven, there are seven earths, because the hadith mentions where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لو أن السماوات السبع وعامرهن غيري والأراضين السبع في كفة. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reported to, or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reported from Allah that Allah said, if the seven heavens and those in them apart from me, and the seven earths, if they were in one side of the scales, and La ilaha illallah was on the other side of the scales. So those are some of the points, nine points that we understand from the hadith. To finish off, inshallah, the chapter, because we are actually running a bit behind from the schedule of lessons, the next hadith, reported by At-Tirmidhi, the author mentions, وَلِلْتِرْمِذِي وَحَسَّنَهُ عَنْ أَنَسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى يَا ابْنَ آدَمَ لَوْ أَتَيْتَنِي بِقُرَابِ الْأَرْضِ خَطَايَا ثُمَّ لَقِيتَنِي لَا تُشْرِكُ بِي شَيْئًا لَأَتَيْتُكَ بِقُرَابِهَا مَغْفِرَةً. This hadith reported by At-Tirmidhi in his Sunan, and also by others, Ad-Darimi, Imam Ahmad also in his Musnad. This hadith reported by At-Tirmidhi, who declared it Hasan, a good hadith, authentic, from Anas radiallahu anhu, who said, I heard Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, Allah Ta'ala said, O son of Adam, if you came to me with the likes of the earth in sins, meaning sins that could fill the earth, but you came to me having not associated any partners with me, having not committed any shirk with me, I would come to you and bestow upon you the likes of that in forgiveness. In forgiveness. Anas, the famous companion Anas is his full name, Anas ibn Malik ibn al-Nadr al-Ansari al-Khazraji. His name is Anas, the son of Malik, the son of al-Nadr, from the Ansar, from the tribe of Khazraj. Khadimu Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the servant of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who served and waited upon the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam from a young age. He served the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam 10 years. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said about him in a hadith, Allahumma akthir malahu wa waladahu wa adkhilhu al-jannah. In a hadith reported from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Prophet said about Anas, Oh Allah, make his wealth plentiful and his children plentiful and admit him into Jannah. He lived a long time. He died in the year 92 after the Hijrah, and it is said by some scholars that it was 93 after the Hijrah, and he was over 100 years old. So the meaning of this hadith then, well, in this hadith we are told that Allah has promised us maghfirah, forgiveness, which we translate as forgiveness, as long as a person does not die upon shirk, upon associating partners with Allah. Maghfirah in Arabic language comes from the word which means as-satr, to hide or cover something. Just as an additional point, example, one of the words for a helmet that, or a piece of armor that the warrior wears on his head to protect his head, to cover his head, is al-mighfar. Al-mighfar, from the same word. So this word ghafara gives the meaning of hiding or covering something. What does maghfirah mean in Islam, which we translate as forgiveness? It means tajawuzullahi an khataya wa dhunubi ibadihi, that Allah letting a person off of his sins. Okay, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lets a person off, that's what we say, forgives him. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives a person, he lets him off his sins, and that is maghfirah, that is forgiveness. So what is the general message of this hadith? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in this hadith from his Lord Azza wa Jal, from Allah, that Allah addressed his servants, Allah addresses his slaves and clarifies to them and shows them his great grace and mercy, that he will forgive the sins no matter how plentiful, how many they are, as long as they are not a shirk, as long as they are not associating partners with Allah, worshipping others besides Allah. And this hadith is actually like the statement of Allah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, the hadith is actually very similar to what Allah said in the Quran. Indeed, Allah does not forgive that partners be associated with him, but he forgives whatever is lesser than that to whomever he wills. So what we learn from this hadith, or the relevance of this hadith to the chapter, is that in this there is evidence, there's a proof in this hadith that there is a plentiful reward for living and dying on Tawheed. And that Tawheed again causes the expiation of sins no matter how many sins a person does. No matter how many they are. Because it's mentioned in hadith, if you came to Allah with sins that were so much that they could fill the earth, but you met Allah not having associated partners with Allah, Allah would give you forgiveness. So what do we learn from this hadith? One, the virtue of Tawheed and the plentiful reward associated with it. Two, the immense grace and benevolence of Allah and His mercy and His generosity and His forgiveness. Thirdly, in this hadith there is a refutation of al-Khawarij, of the Khawarij sect amongst the Muslim Ummah, who used to declare a person to be a kafir, who used to declare a person to be a non-Muslim, an apostate, if he had done a major sin lesser than shirk. The sect of al-Khawarij, who appeared early on in the history of Muslims and survive to this day, are those people who essentially regard a person to be a non-Muslim if he makes, or if he falls into a major sin. They declare that this person is not a Muslim anymore. This hadith refutes them. It refutes them by, because we know that Allah forgives all of the sins. He can forgive all of the sins as long as a person does not make shirk with Allah, which means that person must still be a Muslim if he's not making shirk with Allah, because Allah doesn't forgive the kuffar. If these persons weren't regarded as Muslims, then there's no forgiveness for them. They're in the hellfire forever. So in this hadith, there is a refutation of al-Khawarij, of the Khawarij sect, who declared people to be kuffar, to be unbelievers, if they did major sins, lesser than a shirk. Fourthly, إثبات الكلام لله عز وجل على ما يليق بجلاله. This hadith also affirms, as many other ahadith and the verses of the Quran do, this hadith affirms that Allah speaks. It affirms the attribute to Allah of al-kalam, words and speech. In a way, of course, that is befitting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's majesty and His greatness. We don't know the nature, the real kayfiyah of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks, but we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kalam. He's described as having this attribute of kalam, of speaking. Because the Prophet ﷺ told us in this hadith that Allah said. Fifthly, bayanun lima'na la ilaha illallah wa annahu tarku shirki qaleeluhu wa kathirahu wa la yakfi qawluha bil lisan. In this hadith there is an explanation of la ilaha illallah, and that it means to leave shirk, to abandon shirk, any amount of shirk, a great amount or a smaller amount. And it is not sufficient just for a person to say la ilaha illallah upon his tongue without backing it up with action and avoiding any falling into a shirk. The last point, sixth point, إثبات البعث والحساب والجزاء. And this hadith again affirms another essential point of the Muslim's belief. It affirms the resurrection and the taking of accounts on the day of resurrection and on the day of judgment, and the reward. Three things. Al-ba'th, that people will be raised to life by Allah after they die. Al-Hisab, that their accounts will be taken. Accounts will be taken, they will be told their good deeds and bad deeds and what is more and what is less. And thirdly, Al-Jaza, they will be given the reward or punishment accordingly. These three things are also implied or indicated in this hadith, as is part of the essential and fundamental belief of a Muslim, that the Muslim knows that he and all mankind will be resurrected after death, and they will have to account for their deeds, and they will be rewarded or punished accordingly. And with that, we finish the chapter number two. We begin tomorrow, bi-ithnillahi ta'ala, with the third chapter, which is entitled "Man haqqaqa at-tawheed dakhala al-jannata bighayri hisab." Whoever perfects tawheed will enter Jannah without even being taken to account, without even having been questioned as to his deeds. أقول هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المؤمنين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.